Episode 110, People Skills. Welcome to Gratitude Geek, the relationship marketing podcast helping micropreneurs find your micro influencer magic. I'm your host, Kandas Rodarte, and this week I'm joined by Terry Begue. Terry started his painting business fresh out of high school with no money, no experience, and no connections. He quickly learned he was just another painter in an overcrowded market. Refusing to settle, he began perfecting his people skills, learning what motivates people to buy and taking away the reasons why they wouldn't buy. And his business blew up. He has refined his process for business and personal growth through customer engagement and retention. Leveraging his unique lessons has allowed his company to grow year after year, even though he hasn't advertised since 2012. Welcome, Terry.
Hi, Kandas. How are you?
Well, I'm really looking forward to this conversation because we have a lot of parallels in our history. So this is going to be a great conversation. I can't wait to get into it. But before we get started, why don't you tell us your unique story? How'd you get to where you are? Who are you? What do you do? I mean, give us your story.
Sure. I have to go all the way back to when I was 18, right out of high school. I wanted to get a good job, but I had a few jobs, but I didn't stick around very long. I was never fired. I don't know. I was just uncomfortable with people telling me what to do. So really what it was, and I didn't realize it at the time, is I was a dyed-in-the-wool entrepreneur. And finally, I figured that out. And I started immediately. Of course, I couldn't take any lessons from anyone or ask for advice. I just started a painting business. Painting because I worked with my older brother a little bit while I was in high school. And it didn't cost much to get into that business. A bucket and a brush and you're on your way. And I had a pickup truck. But I suffered horribly for a long time because I tried to figure everything out on my own. I had an old beat up truck. I'd show up really not knowing what to say to customers. I had no training, no experience. And looking back, that was a huge mistake. But I married my wife at a very young age. I was 21. She was 19. And I made a lot of big promises to her that I'm a business owner. We're going to live a good life. I'm going to buy you the house you want. All these promises I made, and I had none of them happened. Here we are, 25, 26, 27. And I'm saying, you know, and I'm almost embarrassed. I'm saying, I don't know what's wrong. And eventually I'll get better at painting and things will come around. And I became a pretty good painter, I have to admit, but nothing changed in my life. And then after that, I thought maybe I'm not working hard enough. I think that was her suggestion. So that I started working hard. I connected with some builders and I was doing entire homes by myself because I couldn't afford any help. And it took so long to get paid from them. So I would just be grinding it out day after day after day. I can remember one time working over 80 straight days without a day off and still nothing really changed for me. I mean, we were barely paying our bills. And then, so I realized that's not working either, but everything changed the day I came home from work smelling like kerosene from, you know, the homes I was working in until there was a furnace and tired. And I found my wife sitting there on the couch with tears in her eyes. I could tell she'd been crying. Never a good sign. Fellas, if you're out, any fellas out there listening, you know, that's not a good sign. And I said, what's wrong? And she had three little words for me that changed everything in my life that day. And they weren't, I love you. They were, Terry, I'm pregnant. That was it. There was something about that, a switch had just flipped in my brain. You know, all of a sudden this crappy lifestyle that I was living and providing was no longer going to cut it. And I promised myself that very day, I'm going to start turning things around. I'm going to take action. And I did a lot of things over the next few months. Joined some professional organizations, started marketing my business in a different way, doing some crazy things. I won't go into detail right now with them. All I'll say is by the time my son was born 8 months later, I had double my income. We were a month from moving into a brand new home. At that time, we were living in a one-bedroom apartment. And I turned everything around. And over the course of the next year, I hired some people and I doubled my income again. And the crazy thing is, I knew what I needed to do for those first 7 or 8 or 9 years, but until I actually put them to practice and took action and became grateful for my customers, and I like to use the word grateful because I know that's your theme, and that was a big part of it. I looked at my customers at first as like they were an adversary almost, like either they hired me and I won, or they didn't hire me and they won, but it wasn't until I realized that they were the very pathway to my success that everything turned around for me. And that was the big game changer for me. And that's what and I've had so much success then over the years. Since then, I've painted over 5,000 homes. I've had different crews working in and out, but we stayed somewhat small. But even though we're small here in Ohio, where we only have 8 months to paint outside, and that's my business, is really exterior painting, we still do almost 100 houses every year. And my customers are so happy with our work. We do nothing but repeat and referral business. And that's why I haven't had to advertise for all these years now. For 10 years now, I haven't advertised, and I don't want to. I mean, I could grow my business and be bigger, but I'm 63. I don't really want to get bigger, but I only take the nicest, easiest, highest paying jobs that I can find and work for the best people. So I love my business now. I'm going to miss retiring someday. Whenever that does happen, I'm not sure, but I love my life right now. And it's all a big part of it is because I have such a great relationship with my customers.
I told you there are parallels in our story. It's like talking to you is kind of like talking to my husband in terms of your story. I want to share this with you though. So my brother-in-law, when my sister and my brother-in-law first got married, my brother-in-law was in sales. He worked for a company and he was a sales rep, an outside sales rep. And my sister got pregnant, and when my niece was born, my brother-in-law had to sign a piece of paper, and on that piece of paper, it said responsible party. And he used that story to catapult his career, the rest of his career. He eventually, when he retired, he was the CEO of a Fortune 50 company, right? Wow. So he went from being at the same company. He went from working in outside sales for this company to being the CEO of this company, right?
Oh my
and
gosh.
Actually, I'm sorry, it was a subsidiary of the company. So mm-hmm. Same parent company, subsidiary CEO. Oh. But he would tell that story. When my daughter was born, I became a responsible party. And there's something about parenthood. It really does. Yeah. It changes. A switch goes on.
Yeah. It changed my life. My daughter was born just 13 months later, and I doubled my income again. I mean, it was like I did the things I knew I should be doing. And I had so much success with it. A lot of people over the last 5 or 10 years have been saying, you should write a book. And so I did. I finally wrote my book entitled Attract and Keep Customers for Life. And that's exactly what it's about. My journey and how I've learned how to create a business there was a time when I had to spend money on advertising and marketing, but eventually if you treat enough people right, they will support you. They will take care of you. And so many people, they think they can burn through customers and they, you know, in the course of their career, but it does catch up with you. And it costs so much money to get new customers, you know, and every week, even though our houses that we paint, they don't need painted again for maybe 12 to 15 years. I still get at least one a week call me back, even after all that time, remember me and want me to come paint their house again. And that's huge.
So I call that relationship marketing. And my husband and I are semi-retired. We still, the custom furniture business still produces, I don't know, a handful of items a year, just whatever my husband wants to build that year. And it's all commissioned work. And we don't advertise because I built relationships with our clients. And so we didn't spend money on advertising and we didn't spend money on marketing, but we spent money on relationships. So I have a system where I send greeting cards and gifts to our clients. And that's, you know, I spend about as much money on sending them greeting cards and gifts as some people spend on ads. But I think the payoff is better by building the relationship.
And it's so much more personal and different. Yeah. Are they getting that from any other business? I doubt it. I mean, so it makes you, and I talk about in my book, it's so important to be different and stand out in a good way.
Exactly.
And I love that idea.
So the other thing that came to mind while you were talking and telling your story is when my husband and I first started out, we had our daughter was tiny. She wasn't walking yet. And my husband didn't do a lot of custom built-ins, but he did a custom built-in for a plumber. And the plumber asked, can I hold your daughter? So I let him hold her and he's holding her and he tells us this story. He's holding my baby and he's telling us this story that he'd been a plumber for 30 years and he liked to tell people that it took him 30 years to become an overnight success. But really, you worked really hard for those first 7 or 8 years, really, really hard to lay the foundation. But it just took that one little thing, and all of a sudden you're an overnight success. It wasn't overnight, but that's kind of what it felt like.
Different from everyone else. And I had to think on it long and hard. And finally, I realized it was my relationship with my customers. All those years when I struggled, I didn't have that. I didn't show any authenticity or transparency in my business. I'd pull up in an old beat up truck at first because it's all I could afford. And it was like the elephant in the room. I'd park out in the street because it leaked oil and hope they wouldn't look at it. And I learned, you know, over time, it was better just to say, hey, you know, sure, I'm working at it. This is the best I can afford, but I pass the savings on to you. I don't have a lot of overhead. So I try to find a way to spend things like that. But becoming just authentic and not asking people to trust me, but just to give me a chance at first in those early years. And that's what I remember working. Seems like when you say trust me, then people, their mind goes right to that used car salesman mentality. But I'd ask people, you know, if you'll give me a chance, if you'll take a chance on me, I won't let you down. And it took some time doing that over and over and over till people started to believe in me. And in my book, I talk about how to create trust, and it's a process through what I call four abilities, and trustability being one of those. So it's worked out well for me, and I've been sharing it with the world.
All right, dig into that. What are they? What are the four?
They're likability, believability, trustability, and then wowability. But the way I looked at it was people aren't going to trust you instantly. There's a process there. So it starts out with being likable. Okay. And I talk about things you do to be likable. One, like when you're with a customer, you don't run your mouth. You pay attention. You listen to them. They called you because they have a problem. If you say you're going to be there at 8 o'clock, I'm there at 10 minutes till eight. You know, I'm always on time. I listen. And there's like 8 or 10 different things in that part of the book about likability. And then even from like, it's still a big leap to go to trust from that. So I put in between that believability or credibility. And I call that the bridge that connects like to trust. That's sort of where you prove you're the real deal. You know, your website maybe show that before and after pictures and testimonials and things like that, that make you believable. They maybe see, jobs that you've done, job signs, and just a little bit of your reputation there before you move on to the trustability part. And then I got some things in there that are really powerful for building trust with customers.
So let's talk about testimonials. Testimonials is one of my favorite topics because it's how I built my business.
Right. They're so powerful. And in my book, I even say on there, right before you start the chapter, I said, if you only do one thing in this book, make it this one. And then I created an entire chapter just on testimonials because I thought that's how important they are. And I started getting testimonials, but I found if I just ask them right there on the spot, it's sort of, they don't think about what to say, or they do and you don't write it down. And it's a whole process of finding out, making sure it's okay to say that and use their name. So I created a form, and it's a free giveaway in my book too. Where people could just download this form, hand it to the customer. It's designed to elicit a positive response. I don't ask them what you didn't like about working, but what you did like about working with us. And it's funny, the things that they talked about weren't things I ever thought they would say. When I asked that question, I thought they would say, well, you guys do a nice job painting. You're clean. You nice straight lines. You do a good job. And it wasn't that. It was all the people skill things that we were talking about. You know, you were polite. You were easy to talk to. You said you'd be there when your crew's easy to talk to. If something was wrong, you didn't mind if we brought it up. I call that permission to nitpick and things like that. So those were the things that made a difference to people. And that's where I got a lot of my where I proved that what I'm doing is right in my book, because this is the very words of what my customers told me. If you go to my website, there's, I don't know, 80 to 150 testimonials there. Nobody's going to read them all, but if they just scroll and see the sheer volume makes a good impression with people, because they, and another thing I say throughout my book over and over is, why wouldn't you use these? They're free. They don't cost anything more than the time it takes to ask and to record them or to write them down. And my customers even do that part for me, and they're easy to do, but there's one thing you got to do first, and it's treat your customer right.
I have three takeaways from that. I hope I remember all of them. So when my husband and I retired in 2017, and then in 2019 or 2020, he decided he was bored. So I had taken our website completely offline, and I had to rebuild it. And the very first page that I rebuilt was the testimonial page, because that's how important testimonials are to a business. So before I did anything, before I added pictures of any of the products, I made sure the testimonials page was done. That was the very first thing I did.
Mm-hmm. What I would like to add, Kandas, is I do a lot of, I love being on podcast shows, and you're the first one I've ever heard say that you also realize the importance of testimonials.
Oh, it's important.
Yeah. And it drives me crazy that other people don't see it. And what drives me crazy the most is they're free. Okay. I keep saying that over and over in my book.
So a lot of folks, they feel like testimonials are bragging. So
not if it's someone else saying it, right? Oh, yeah. Well, what I say, the very words in my book, if you say it, it sounds like hollow bragging. If someone else says it who has nothing to gain by saying anything good to you, it speaks volumes. It's 1,000 times more believable than anything you can say. And I think I put testimonials under believability because it's what other people who have used your service. So it's people like yourself, you know, that other people that are looking to use my service, they see other, and some of them, they go scroll through the list and they recognize names on there. I don't give the address or a phone number, but I always put the customer's name. And some even say, oh my gosh, if you painted for this guy, you can paint for me because he's really picky. You know, some neighbors I see, because we get in a neighborhood, people start looking at their house that's built same time. And then they look at the house we just painted and it's like day and night difference. So that sells the job a lot too.
Well, things like Google My Business, it's not called Google My Business anymore, but it's the same thing. So things like Google My Business and Facebook and all those sites, they have the ability for your clients to leave ratings and reviews of you, of your and your company. That means that it's important. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know absolutely. That when one of the first things that I do when I'm shopping on Amazon is I look at the reviews. To see,
yeah, you know. Everybody does, especially the younger, the millennials, they're all checking those out, you know, because they grew up with phones. So it's so easy. And they're looking at it on their phone before they even get home a lot of times when they see my job sign I found. Yeah. And when you do that, it's important that it's your website is suited. It also can see everything on the phone. You know, I'm not really sure how to explain that because I'm not a millennial.
No. That's true. And your phone number, no one's going to call you. I swear. No one is ever going to call. I can't remember the last time a client called me, but they do text.
Yeah.
People. So it's okay to put your phone number on your website. Trust me. It's okay. No one will call you. And if you have a problem with that, there's lots of services that you can get that will give you a phone number and it doesn't ring your phone. It creates a voicemail. Right.
Right.
It's
right.
Okay. You can put your phone number on your website.
And another thing. Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just want to say real quick, another thing that drives me crazy when it does come to the phone numbers is when they do call me and I call them back, I'll bet 9 out of 10 of my customers say you're the only painter to call me back. And I don't understand that because these other guys, they got to be paying for advertising and marketing, unlike me, but they're not even using it. As soon as they get busy, they don't call back until they need work again. And it's such a crazy way of looking at business.
It is a crazy way of looking at business because you're really, really busy. And then you're not. And then what do you do when you're not busy? I remember those times. I actually developed, I don't know, I guess we'd been in business about 10 years. When did 2008 happen? Yeah, it was about 10 years. 2008 happened 10 years after we launched our business. And things changed. The economy changed. And there are some months where we didn't get any new orders. And we just figured out, you know, a way to do things. But because I own my own business, I'm never, ever afraid of not having enough money because there's always a way to make money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as long as you don't burn any bridges, there's some way to make money. And we've never, you know, even in the really lean months when no one had money, we were good because there's a mindset around that.
Yeah. And you know, and I think both of us are talking about is being proactive in your business. You know, so many people, they wait for things to come to them, but no, I mean, that's why I can never have a brick and mortar business. I'd go crazy. I think sitting behind a counter waiting for somebody to come in the door. But yeah, when you stay proactive, when you're out there and you're doing whatever you need to do to get business, it's there and you'll find it. But you gotta be excited to make it happen on your own, you know, figure it out.
And a lot of that is niching too. I mean, you have a niche. You paint for high-end houses. I mean, I'm sure you don't take any of the
we've niched like you wouldn't believe. I mean, my whole life has been one big, and now we're niched so down so much. I mean, can I tell you how, when at first we took anything you can imagine. If somebody was going to pay me, I can remember even vacuuming carpets for people. I was so desperate for money, and they said, well, yay, $20. And I would do it. But then it got to the point where I would only take the better jobs. But then I niched down even more to where we found there was more money to be made painting outsides of homes, because everybody can paint inside and homeowners can paint inside, but the outside, that was harder to do. And it commanded a better dollar rate. It had a higher perceived value. So then I started doing that. Then I realized that I didn't want to work for realtors and contractors, people who get a cut or they're not being actually benefiting from the job. So then I niched to where I'm only working for homeowners, because they pay me right away. They're easy to get along with and great to work for. And then that was going well. And then I niched down. I got so busy with that, I niched more into saying, we're only going to do jobs where we can spray, mask and spray, because we can paint much faster. And then it was just that. Then it got to the point where I got so busy again. And I'm talking 40, 50 houses booked ahead in the summertime, where I thought, we only have 100 nice days in Ohio. The way I figured it out, if you minus out for rainy days and weekends, there's about 100 days we can paint outside, and we get about 150 people want us to paint their home. So I realized that since we can't do them all, we're only going to do aluminum and cedar sided homes. So we niched even more so for homeowners only outside. And that's where we're at right now. And I still turn customers away. But the point I wanted to make was, the more I niched my business, it seemed like the more people wanted me. It's a crazy, another one of those crazy things.
Yeah, it is crazy. So our niche is that my husband makes king size beds for people who collect antiques, because you cannot get an antique bed in king size.
Oh my God.
So he makes antique looking beds, king size, for people who collect antiques.
And you have all the business you want.
And we have all the business we want.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that is so amazing. It seems almost counterintuitive. But yeah, until you actually experience it, it's not that way. If you're in demand, people want you no matter what.
Well, and if you do a really good job too, I mean, you do a good job, people want you because you do a good job. Right. People hire him because he does a good job. You know, your reputation precedes you. And that goes back to testimonials.
Exactly.
Right. Yep, if they weren't introduced to you through a referral, you've got to, using testimonials is not bragging. It's smart business. Okay. Yeah. I want to talk about wowability, because I love that term, wowability. Talk to me about that.
Wowability? Mm-hmm. Yes. I mentioned like, believe, and trust. Those are kind of selling skills. Wowability is also what I call referrals on steroids. It's all about getting those, what we just talked about, referrals and testimonials. Although it does help you sell jobs if you have the wowability, it's what keeps you in the customer's mind when they need painting again, or inside work, maybe in the wintertime, we might want to do repeat business. And referral business is all about wowing your customers. And there are certain things that I do that other people don't do, even though they could, and it doesn't cost anything, they choose not to. And one that I think of is what I call risk reversal. And all I mean by that is, I tell the customer when I'm right there with them, I make a lot of promises, though, in person, verbally, and in writing, and I keep every one of them. But risk reversal, they'll say something like, well, will you be sending me a contract? Do I need to sign it? How much down? And I say, no, I don't need you to sign it. I'll send you a proposal. I don't like the word contract. You don't need to give me any money down, and I won't turn a bill in until you're satisfied with the work. And they're blown away when I say that. Some of them think you're going to get burnt on that. And I did get burnt once in 5,000 homes, though. So, and knowing what I know now, I should never, that was a long time ago, and that guy was going to burn me no matter what. And I've learned how to, there's just little tells, you know, you learn after a while. But what I found is most people, and I say this right to them, is I found it, most people aren't looking to beat you out of a buck. They just want you to do what you promise. And my competition, even when I'm speaking to groups of painters and people in their trades, I say, you guys are probably all doing it as well. They say, no, I'm not. And then I'll just look at someone and I'll say, if something goes wrong on the job, you know, what do? You know, that say, well, if we know about it, we fix it. And I say, exactly. So why not? You assume the risk of guaranteeing your work. So now why not reap the benefits of it? Why not let them know? You know, at first I was afraid to bring it up, because you think it's maybe going to cause nitpicking. You know, if they say, oh, I don't got to pay till I'm happy, then no, but the people don't. As long as you know what they expect and you do more, you know, over promise, over deliver is another thing that I categorize under wow ability. It doesn't become a problem. I found people pay me almost sooner because they're uncomfortable me doing all this work and then they're not giving me any money. They go, do you want your check yet? I said, no, I'm going to make sure you're happy first. And it's funny. And again, it sounds counterintuitive, but it works. And I did, until I started doing it, I didn't realize there was a second benefit. I tell my crew, I say, you guys, you know, we're not getting paid until the owner is happy. And that's all there is to it. And if you want paid, then I got to get paid. And so it forces everybody on my team to just sort of raise the bar a little. We make sure the customers are happy.
Do you find that because you have that mindset that it makes you a more nitpicky customer, or is your level of expectation when you're purchasing something from someone else higher, do you think?
I know, again, there's a question nobody's ever asked me that before. I guess I do expect them to do a quality job when it's for me. You talk about if I'm the customer, but I don't know that I really nitpick. No, I don't think so. I don't think I do.
The reason why I asked is because last summer we had some trees removed and part of the agreement was that they were going to grind the stumps. Mm-hmm. And so the owner of the company says, well, you know, can I get paid? And my husband's like, the stumps haven't been ground yet. You can get paid when the stumps are ground. And that day the owner came with a stump grinder and ground the stumps so that we could pay him. Oh, so, yeah, we shouldn't have had to ask for that. You know,
right.
And
he knew basically when the job's done, he was going to get paid going into the deal. Right.
And the job wasn't done because the stumps hadn't been ground yet.
Boy, that's the best way to get it done, right? You never would have got it done that day if you hadn't said that.
Oh, yeah. Well, so I think that because we've always, when we delivered a product, it was always more than the customer expected because we didn't want to have to deal with the nitpicking, right? We raised the bar when you give your customers permission. And because we make custom furniture that's supposed to complement their antique furniture, we, at the very beginning, they are nitpicking because they want, you know, we have to go back and forth on the color choices and the wood choices. And we have to make sure that the wood grain is going to look good with the wood grain of whatever it is that they antiques. And the antique furniture is made from wood that we can't get anymore because it's 200 years old. I mean, there's so many things. Oh, so from the beginning, there's nitpicking. Yeah. So when we finally delivered the product, we do not want any more nitpicking. So our level is up here. And this, obviously, the tree guy, his level is down here. So as a homeowner, if we wanted to hire a painter of your caliber, what should we be looking for as the homeowner?
Well, as a matter of fact, I have another form that I give my customers and it puts me on their side. It's called the Customer Awareness Guide. And that's exactly what it is. 6 questions that you should ask, because people in my industry, there's a lot of horror stories and shady contractors out there because it's so easy to get into the business. And so I created a paper and I used to use this in my marketing. I even had it put in my little newspaper here in town, and 6 things to ask the painter before you hire him. And some of those, if you're asking me what some of those are, one is, oh gosh, now I'm not going to be able to think of it. Can you give me some testimonials? Other people like me, other homeowners in town that I can talk to. And if they can't, you know, why not? So that raises a flag. Are you insured? And so many people, and I say, don't just ask if they're insured, ask to see proof. And whenever I send a bid by email, I also email a copy of my liability policy and a copy of my workers' compensation, because you got to be legit. And a lot of guys aren't insured. I know a painter that would tell customers he's insured and he was just talking about insurance on his truck. He didn't have a liability policy. And there's a lot of stories out there. So there's 6 things that is in that paper. And again, that's another thing I used to do to set myself apart. And I think I give it away for free in my book, Attract and Keep Customers, that Customer Awareness Guide.
So there'll be a link to his book in the show notes. It's momgeek.com/110 or gratitudegeek.com episode 110. You can get there. Those, both of those, you know, here's a marketing tip. Both of those URLs go to the same place. Just saying. Okay. Have to reinvent the wheel. Okay. Before we wrap up with the pandemic, It gave us the opportunity to do things that we normally wouldn't do. So I looked at the pandemic as an opportunity and not a liability. And one of the things that happened was I belong to a networking organization called BNI, Business Network International. It's the world's largest networking organization. And the pandemic was March something. And the following week, we were all meeting online. Everybody in the world was meeting online. And so one thing that you can do if you belong to a BNI chapter is that you can visit any other chapter twice every 6 months. So I said, okay, I want to visit other chapters. So I actually visited a chapter in San Luis Obispo, California, because California is in a different is in a later time zone than me, so I didn't have to wake up as early. And the painter in the group was doing his weekly presentation, his 10-minute weekly featured presentation. So he did 10 minutes on his business, you know, to build the know, like, and trust for the members of the chapter. And one of the things that he did was show us a copy of his proposal versus his competitor's proposal. His competitor's proposal said paint house, $10,000. And his proposal had everything you just said, my insurance policy in place, here's my, you know, my guarantee, here's this and this, and here is the itemization. We're gonna tape the corners. We're gonna paint the molding this color. We're gonna paint the floorboards this color. We're gonna paint the walls this color. Itemize, $15,000. Right. So he charged more, but he told them why.
Yeah.
Which I love it. Which is, I just thought it was, and I'm sure that your proposals are itemized as well.
It is so funny you said you told that story, because I tell a story like that in my book of a guy that he just wrote prep and paint home. So he had three things: pressure wash the house, prep and paint home, clean up at the end, three items. And I wrote what prep is, you know, pressure clean, sand where there's peeled wood, prime with oil-based primer, all the little steps. And I filled up the whole thing. And the funny thing about it was I knew the painter, and he's an excellent painter. It's just, he chose not to give more information. I think that's part of my believability. And in that part of the book is where I talk about, be specific and give more information. You know, maybe the customer's never going to do anything with all that information, but it puts them at ease. And that's so important. But you're point on with what you're saying.
Yeah. And, you know, most of your customers are never going to care about what each of those steps means. But for the 1% who does, it makes all the difference in the world.
And it sets you apart. Yep.
It does. Exactly. And it really does make you puts you in a position where you can charge more.
Yep, exactly. And it shows you take your business seriously.
Exactly. All right. I wish I could talk to you more, but it's time. Yeah. It's time to wrap up. So Terry, share your moment of gratitude.
My moment of gratitude, the one moment I was grateful. What I'm the most grateful for, that I show the most gratitude, is for my customers. As I said, in the beginning, they were just part of all this whole mess that I had to deal with, you know, to own my own business. But what I realized is if you take care of your customers, they will take care of you. So I'm so grateful for them. And that's it. That is the big thing in my life. That was the reason I wrote the book, was because I learned that when you take care of your customers, you know, they don't need us, we need them, and they will take care of you. They will make sure they'll pay your price. They'll refer you to their friends. And life is so much easier when your customers trust you.
Thanks for joining us this week for Gratitude Geek, the relationship marketing podcast, helping micropreneurs find your micro influencer magic. Be sure to check the show notes at gratitudegeek.com, episode 110, for links to all the groovy resources mentioned today, including Terry's book. And while you're there, why not subscribe to the show on Audible, iTunes, Stitcher, or any of your favorite podcast players. Our theme music is Track 14 by Rev Rock and Soul Lily. I've been your host, Kandas Rodarte, inviting you to join me on my mission to spread gratitude, sow seeds of appreciation, and harvest a bounty of generosity and kindness. Stay groovy, my friends. I know we can make it easier than they can. We can make it better than before. I know we can make it easier than they can. We can make it better. Some things just can't be ignored.
There's never wrong answers
in a podcast.
Okay, just act like you know what you're saying, huh?
That was a good quote.